Good evening and welcome to the January 21st, 1992 Planning Board meeting for Cape Elizabeth. Notice most people still have their jackets on. I hope it warms up in here. The first order of business tonight, the approval of the minutes of the previous meeting, December 17, 1991. Are there any comments, corrections, changes? Seeing none, do I hear a motion? It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All in favor of accepting the December 17th minutes as written, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's a unanimous vote. Thank you. Correspondence this evening. Most of it was just on the podium tonight. First item of correspondence is a January 16th, 1992 letter from Michael Hill, Monahan, Leahy. How do you pronounce that? Hakadal and Libby. Thank you. In reference to site plan review, non-conforming sign, lending some legal advice as to the site plan review and its implications on a non-conforming sign, one of which we have before us this evening, basically stating that the planning board has the power to approve, deny, or conditionally approve the application based on its review of the required information. States that, in their opinion, it's broad enough to grant planning board, the planning board, the power to review what would otherwise be grandfathered, a grandfathered non-conforming sign. Second item is a handwritten letter from a Christina Hamlet to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. Ms. Hamlet is a resident of 350 Ocean House Road and is writing in reference to the Tinsman Health Facility, the Fitness Center site plan review before us. Saying they have no objection to the lighted sign at the Tinsman and Associates. Third item of correspondence is from a John Casey and Andy Strout, handwritten letter dated the 21st of January. As teacher, coaches, and residents of Cape Elizabeth, stating their wholehearted support of Tom Tinsman's Fitness Center effort. Is there any other correspondence that should be brought before the board? Okay, we'll move on to our first order of old business. We're right on schedule. First order of old business, earth materials removal permit renewal request by Leland P. Murray of Bluestone Quarry to renew the earth annual earth materials permit, section 19-3-8. I'd refer the board members to that section. If you have your ordinance with you, I think it's on page, starts page 37. Have the material before us? Oh, I thought I did. Now I do. This is an annual permit renewal. I'd ask if Mr. Murray or a representative of Bluestone Quarry is here just to approach the podium, introduce yourself, and give a brief presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I am Leland Murray, requesting the annual permit for Bluestone Quarry under the same conditions as it was issued last year. To my knowledge, there hasn't been any complaints or any problems over there that have been brought to my attention, so I'll be here to entertain any questions you have.
I guess it is an option of the board to also hold a public hearing at this time. The number of members of the public here, and I'm not sure which article they may be here. Would the board want to open it up for a public hearing in case there's any?
Sure.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Murray. We'll probably have some questions after the public hearing.
Okay.
And so I'll publicly open the hearing. If there are any members of the public who want to speak on the application for annual renewal of the permit, the Bluestone Quarry, just ask that you keep your comments brief and concise, and not repeat anybody else's other comments. Anybody from the public wish to speak? Seeing and hearing none, I'll close the public hearing and ask Mr. Murray if he'd like to join us again. And now we can entertain any questions, comments from the board. Judy?
Mr. Murray, I understand that this is a rough plan, and I understand how you add new excavation areas each year. And the area you have marked on 1992 toward the right side of our map, I don't know how scaled that off is, but the ordinance says that no excavation is supposed to be within 100 feet of your property line. And I, just eyeballing it, it looks like it would fall within 100 feet. Are you planning to be that close?
No.
Okay.
Not within 100 feet.
My only concern then about that is that we might have some condition in there simply restating what is required in the ordinance. And I might have another question then for Maureen, our planner. Reading the ordinance carefully this time, the...
I may be leaving.
Ask the questions real quickly, please.
This is of Maureen. There was something that we had to find that the operation has been conducted in accordance with previous conditions. I assume that's true, isn't it? That these conditions which we have required before are usually met.
Right. If these conditions wouldn't be met, which are tied directly to the requirements of the ordinance, then there would have been complaints filed and there would be some kind of enforcement report, and there is none as far as I'm aware.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions? I just have a couple questions dealing mostly with any storage on site. Do you ever store any petroleum fuels, solvents, other chemicals on site? Okay. How about any other debris, junk, non-operative type machinery?
Just equipment.
Okay. I have no other questions. Are there any other questions, comments? Seeing none, do I hear a motion? And whoever volunteers for the motion has a lot of reading to do. That's why they're not volunteering real quickly, I think. Judith?
Findings of fact, Leland P. Murray of Bluestone Quarry, located at 1019 Sawyer Road, requires a one-year renewal. Do I have to read all that? One-year renewal of earth materials removal permit under section 19-3-8 of the zoning ordinance. Number two, this facility will conduct blasting and transport operation which could endanger the public health, safety, and welfare. Number three, the applicant has substantially addressed the requirements needed for issuance of a special permit for removal of earth materials. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and on the information presented, the application of Leland P. Murray of Bluestone Quarry for renewal of an earth materials permit be granted by the Planning Board for a one-year period beginning January 22, 1992, and ending with the regular January 1993 meeting of the Planning Board, and in accordance with Section 19-3-8 of the Zoning Ordinance, subject to the following conditions. Number one, the applicant shall keep accurate records of any and all blasting operations, including times and dates of such operations and information on size and placement of all charges. Number two, all blasting shall be performed by or under the direct personal supervision of a person qualified, experienced, and regularly engaged in such work, and shall be done in a manner which shall not endanger the health or safety of any person or damage any real or personal property on or off the quarry site. Representatives of the applicant shall be present at the time of the blasting operation. Three, the applicant shall maintain comprehensive general public liability insurance with coverage not less than $500,000 per person and per occurrence for bodily injury or death, and not less than $100,000 per occurrence for property damage. 4, the schedule for any blasting and drilling shall be submitted by the applicant to the building inspector at least 7 days prior to the commencement of the work. The schedule shall include the name of the drilling and or blasting subcontractor who will perform the work and a certificate of insurance for such subcontracting. The schedule shall be approved by the building inspector prior to the commencement of the work. Drilling and blasting shall be scheduled for no more than 1/2 day at a time. 5. No operation shall be conducted at the quarry on Saturday, Sunday, or holidays, except that stone may be loaded and trucked from the site on Saturdays. 6. No machinery or equipment shall be operated before 9 a.m. or after 6 p.m. on any day, except that loading of trucks may take place between 7:30 a.m. and 4:30 p.m. Fencing and appropriate signs shall be maintained. The corporation shall maintain at least 12 signs, 3 on each side of the property, reading, "Danger, no trespassing." 8. Leland Murray shall make a reasonable attempt to notify Cape Elizabeth residents along the Sawyer and Stillman Street in the vicinity of the quarry prior to any blasting operation. 9. Not more than 10,000 cubic yards of material shall be removed during the term of this permit. And 10. If the building inspector finds at any time that the health, safety, or welfare of area residents or property is threatened by the quarry operations, he or she is authorized and directed to order that all work at the site be suspended immediately and to require that operations be resumed only after further action by the planning board. That's it.
It has been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It has been moved and seconded. Do I hear any further discussion? Judy?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to suggest 2 amendments to the motion. Under the finding of facts, I would recommend a 4th finding to read, the conduct of this operation has been in accordance with all conditions imposed by previously issued special permits. And under the condition section, a number 11 to read as follows, no part of the extraction operation shall be permitted within 100 feet of the property line, and natural vegetation shall be left and maintained on the undisturbed land. Both of those come directly from the ordinance.
Are those amendments acceptable to the motion or?
Yes.
And the second? E? Four?
Certainly.
Thank you. Any other discussion? Comments?
Just a matter of clarification. In some instances, we refer to Leland Murray, and in the condition number 7, we refer to the corporation. Are they one and the same?
Yep.
Any other questions, comments? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand.
As read and amended.
And amended, I'm sorry. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Thank you.
Thank you.
See you again next year. Our second order of old business, and we're slightly ahead of schedule. The Tinsman Fitness Center, request by Thomas Tinsman for site plan review of the conversion of approximately 1,000 square feet of space from office use to a fitness center. Site plan review, section 19-2-9. I'd ask Maureen to just quickly bring us up to date where we stand with this article before us.
This application was presented to the board at, I believe, the October meeting, and it was found to be conditionally complete. It was tabled at the November meeting. At the December meeting, it was reaffirmed to be complete, and a public hearing was held. And at the December meeting, there was a decision to table the application pending the submission of further items. And it was specifically tabled to the February meeting with the understanding that if those items were submitted, that the applicant would be able to come back before the board at the January meeting, which this one is. There has been a public hearing held, and the board may take action as it sees fit at this meeting. Any questions at this time?
Any questions of our planner? Just as a matter of proceeding on this, and I want to keep it within, hopefully within the time allotted. There has been additional communication here by letter. I sense that there are other people in the public that have an interest. There is no public hearing scheduled for tonight as such, but I would like to proceed that we ask the applicant to come back to the podium, just bring us up to date with changes that we see in our packet this month, and if it's the board's wishes, to hear from any other people who may wish to speak, not on the terms of a public hearing as such. Public hearings require public notice. But I'll leave it up to the wishes of the board as to allowing other people other than the applicant to speak. This time, why don't, before we make that decision, why don't we have the applicant or a representative come to the podium, introduce yourself, and bring us up to speed where we are.
My name is Tom Tinsman. I'm the applicant. As you know, the last few meetings, I've pretty much not said anything. I've come up here and tried to let the facts speak for themselves. I felt right from the beginning that this is a very small-scale application. Thought it was very simple, and I found out that it's a little bit more involved than I thought. So please bear with me as I go into some of these facts. I understand that what you have before you is just a set of papers, and what I'll try to do is bring this project to life a little bit to you. I know that I've spent a lot of time thinking and planning about this project, and sometimes it's easy to assume that you might know some of the things that I do. Basically, my request is to convert office space in my building to a fitness center. And this would involve conversion of one floor out of three of my building, primarily the walk-in level floor of my building. And looking at my building, I've got basically two options. One is to keep it as real estate space and hire a few more brokers, or provide another service that I think is needed in this town, which to me is a fitness center. Now, the proposal that you have before you is not really like any other fitness center that I think any of you would be aware of. Most of us think of fitness centers as a place with the rows and rows of machines with lots of mirrors and people bulking up and taking steroids. That's not what I have planned. Ah. Make it out of hand. No. This is a very small-scale project. As you see from the application, it involves less than 1,000 square feet. It will be a more personalized center where there will be a personal trainer in the facility working with people on a more personalized basis. Also, it is a facility that will be located nearer to people than what is currently out there for facilities like this. Most people in Cape Elizabeth have to travel either to Portland, Scarborough, or into South Portland to find anything resembling this. So I think it will be very unique and something that we can all be proud of. It will be geared to all ages. There will be a cardiovascular area for people to work out on their cardiovascular needs for endurance and whatnot. There'll be a strength training area where people can work out on toning and strength. One item here that also I think is a big need for people today with injuries is a rehabilitative possibilities of having the right types of equipment to work out on with a doctor's guidance. There'll also be wellness training with dietary counseling and training for sports enhancements. Now, because of all these these items, the fact that it is a small-scale offering, it will be one that has a better ratio of trainers to people working out. It will have basic equipment for the necessities. It won't have a lot of rows and rows of items. It will be a no-frills type of arrangement. It will be one that will be geared to specific needs. And basically what it comes down to is a business decision to try to utilize the building to the highest and best use that I see possible, keeping in mind that a real estate office and a fitness center are both accepted uses in the business zone that I'm located in. At the last meeting, going over the site plan review items, you requested that I turn in certain more information by January 3rd, which I have done. Certain things like the hours of operation, which is in your package, parking, which is also in your package, and I might like to point out that I do currently have more parking spaces than are required under the ordinance. There was a request for noise. I'm not really sure what you meant by this, but I have put in certain items to address this, and I think primarily the hours of operation and the fact that all activities will be held inside the building should address the noise issue. Lighting. The only lighting located on the property is a porch light on the back of the building, which is around the corner from the residential property next door. Cannot be seen from next door. There is also a floodlight located on the back of the building that shines at the parking lot toward the high school. Again, not in the direction of the residential property. And it is a standard residential spotlight, floodlight. And then the only other light that I have that shows up at night is the sign, which I'll get into in a minute. You asked for a survey to show the boundary of the property bordering the residential property. I've submitted that. You've asked for a buffering plan, and more specifically, an aggressive buffering plan. And I'd like to refer to the color photographs that you have in your packet, noting that there are 7 40-foot evergreen trees, 10 sections of stockade fence, 12 rhododendron plants, numerous other plantings on the neighboring property. As you'll see in your package, I've proposed, if the board deems it necessary, to install more sections of fence, which would completely hide the back of the building from the property next door and completely hide all the parking area. As the survey shows you, there is no room on my property to put any further plantings. As a matter of fact, the 12 rhododendrons that I planted are on the neighboring property. And the driveway, as you note on the survey, is about a foot away from the sideline, near the right-of-way. And that driveway was there when I purchased the property. Since the last meeting, I've also had an opportunity to meet with Randy Blake, a representative of the Reaches next door, and have walked the property next door. We talked about what my proposal was. I noticed that Randy is here tonight and would probably like to say something, but I've got to admit to you that walking along the wall facing my property at the residential house, I could not see where the light of the sign or the floodlight or any lights from my property are shining in any of the windows. And nor have I had any complaints from the people living at the property next door in the 2 years that I've been there. There is some spillage of light over onto the grass area of the lawn, but I believe that the 12 rhododendrons that were planted, when they're allowed to grow, will completely shade that. The sign issue, the sign that is in front of my property is a sign that we use for the real estate office. It was installed at the property when I moved there 2 years ago, over 2 years ago, and met all the codes in existence at that time. Since that time, the sign ordinance has changed. and my sign and others in town were grandfathered to be able to continue to exist. The only change I propose to my sign is to put new inserts into the top section of the sign so that the broken parts that are there now can be repaired, and also will have new wording to mention that there is a fitness center at the property. I've also instructed the sign people to make the sign darker at night, which you'll see in your color photo there in your packet. The daytime sign will show some blue behind the white letters, but at night that blue area will be completely blacked out so that all you'll see is the dark ERA logo and white letters showing the name of the real estate company. Underneath that, there will be black letters stating the name of the fitness center. No changes are proposed to the bottom part of the sign, the reader board sign. Now, as far as the sign goes, I feel very strongly about this. The sign is a very necessary business tool for my business. It allows me to advertise my properties. It allows me to recognize brokers who have done good achievements. But just as important as that, it allows me to participate in the community by honoring local people that have done things that should be noted, to announce upcoming events, and to allow me to participate in the community also. One of the things that I read in the comprehensive plan is that the comprehensive plan stated that they would like to have more community involvement in the center of our town. They'd like to see more business development in the center of town that would cater to the local people. And I believe that this sign allows me, in my limited capacity, to participate in the community in those items. And then I'll come back to the sign issue. One other thing that you asked for was a performance bond. It came up at one of the other meetings that I was late planting the rhododendrons bordering my property. Had 1,000 things when I moved into that office 2 years ago to do to get it open and operating and get the business going. The one thing that we needed to do, and I got done late, was planting the rhododendrons. I apologize for that, but they're in place now. Any work that I'm proposing to do prior to opening the fitness center will be completed prior to opening. I don't want to get into setting money aside in escrow accounts and going through legal means to hold up money to make sure that work is done. It will be done prior to opening. Don't want to get a bad reputation with your people. There's a couple of things in your packet tonight that I'd like to clear up. One thing is in your memorandum, item number 4 states that no additional buffering along the length of driveway has been proposed. If you'll notice on the survey map, there is more sections of fence proposed to go along the driveway. Also at the end where it says, therefore be it ordered, if you did decide to make a decision tonight, it says that all work would have to be commenced by January 21st. Or that the site plan approval shall expire on January 21st if development has not commenced by that time. I would hope that that would be 93, not 92. All right, I got a long night ahead of me. And in a letter that you received from Ernie McVeigh, the building inspector, he mentioned that conditions had not been met on the original site plan. And that letter was dated, I think, January 15th, and that's an error. All the plantings have been done, the fence is up. I think he indicated that the fence had not been installed. It's clear on the site plan there that there are 10 sections of fence, starting at the back section of the parking area. And if any of you have had an opportunity to come to visit the site in the last month or so, you'll see that there are clearly 10 sections of fence as depicted on the site plan that was approved. What I'm looking for tonight, obviously, is approval from the planning board to open a fitness center at 349 Ocean House Road. I am asking that my sign, which is a necessary tool for my business, not be a condition of opening up a fitness center. I do not want to see my sign altered. I am asking that the board, especially if you've had an opportunity to look at the buffering, deem the buffering aggressive and not in need of anything other than stockade fence planted along the driveway. And I'd ask you also to keep in mind, and this isn't something that you can put in concrete, but there's been a lot of issue made about the fact that I border a residential zone and that the residential zone has its rights. I would like to believe that the town is not hostile towards business. I would like also for the town to think that a business has rights. And I'd also like you to keep in mind that the residential zone next to me may at some point be back here before the board as a commercial zone. It's very strange that the commercial zone is one building next to the high school entrance and then stops, and that there's one residential property between there and Fowler Road. So I'd ask you to keep that in mind. And I don't know if this is really appropriate to say or something, but it's really been giving me a hard time. I was before this board a couple of years ago, and I was told by a board member at that time that the planning process is a give-and-take situation. And I can see where that would apply to some situations where a developer is asking for certain things in lieu of giving up certain things. Everything that I've requested from this board has been right by the book. There are no variances. I'm not asking for anything that's not allowed. And I would ask that the board not ask for anything in return that is not deemed justified. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Tinsman. I guess at this time, I'll ask the board, as far as a consensus, how they'd like to proceed. We'd like to hear from people with an understanding this is not a public hearing time. There seem to be a lot of public interest. If not, that's fine. If so, if we limit the amount of time. Any comment?
I guess I'd like to hear from Mr. Blake first as the representative of the property next door, and I have no objection to hearing as many other people from the public as wish to speak.
I agree with you.
That seems to be a consensus. That, and I guess if we hear from Mr. Blake, who has in the past represented the abutters, we certainly need to allow other people to speak on the application. Again, it's not a public hearing. Just so I have some sense, how many people are here tonight that would like to just make some type of comment on this application? You raise your hands up as well. It's actually 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. In the interest of trying to keep the time limits, we have another application following this one. I want to limit your comments, if we can, to 2 or 3 minutes. Try not to repeat what somebody has just said. I guess we'll start with Mr. Blake, if you'd like to speak.
My name's Richard Blake. I live at Ivy Road, Cape Elizabeth, and I represent Mrs. Reese, who owns the property next door. Mr. Tinsman mentioned that Tom and I did meet. We looked at the property on the interior, the exterior. We walked over into Mrs. Reese's land and did look back. He showed me the survey, and we discussed the sign. I've talked to Mrs. Reese. It was unfortunately late today. They've been away and went over the issues, and I'll just reiterate what we would like to have the planning board consider as they deliberate the application. As I stated before, we aren't here to necessarily have Mr. Tinsman denied. We just want to see that it's done properly with a minimum impact on Mrs. Reisch's property. The first issue is that the fence is delineated on the survey, does encroach onto Mrs. Reisch's land. We would like to have any approval conditioned on having that fence removed and set entirely within Mr. Tinsman's land. The next issue was hours of operation. We discussed those with Tom. He mentioned what the hours would be. We had some concerns, particularly with the early hours and the late hours, particularly on the weekend. The current residents does hear Mr. Tinsman parking lot traffic coming and going early in the morning. They haven't complained because it hasn't been burdensome to them. However, I think with the fitness center coming in, perhaps on an earlier basis, that will be a problem. The sign, we have looked at that issue. Tom has offered to do something with the top part of the sign to darken it with the hopes of having a minimal impact on Mrs. Reisch's property. I've looked at it, talked to Mrs. Reisch, gone back to the property and looked again. It doesn't seem to be the top part of the sign that causes most of the problem. Most of the light is illuminated from the bottom part, which is the larger area. We would like to see something done with that sign, certainly, and perhaps something Mr. Tinsman can consider is having the side towards Mrs. Reisch's property dim, similar to the top part of the sign, and then he could use the other sign, which faces the commercial zone, to do his advertising. An alternative which we'd also like to consider is have the sign turned off at 10 o'clock at night. On the issue of buffering, the fence is there. The rhododendrons, if you go look, they are—they may just be above snow level right now. I think it'll be a number of years before they have a significant impact. We would like to see the planning board require as much buffering as possible. There are a number of high trees that were planted by the ancestors of Mrs. Reisch. Those helped to a great extent, but they, as I say, stated previously, the bottom limbs are very high above the ground level, and that's where the main impact is. And then Tom's requirement, which he raised tonight, which I had forgotten about, was a performance bond. If you look at your files, you'll see at least two letters and a couple of calls from me in the past regarding his lack of performance on installing any of the things required at earlier approvals. We would like to see something done, whether it's in the way of a bond or the holding of a certificate of occupancy until anything that the planning board requires is complete. Those are the main issues we have, and after I listen to other people here tonight, I may have some thoughts of rebuttal. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anybody else like to speak? Where'd all the hands go? Any other people like to speak on the issue? I'm avoiding calling it a public hearing. I'd just like to hear any other issues that, that people have. Mr. Pesos. If you could introduce yourself.
My name is Harold Pesos. I live at 882 Shore Road. My concern is the fitness center. I've been talking to Tom a long time about a fitness center, and it's been a long time coming. I think it would be a great addition to the community, and I hope that this can be resolved in a way to let Tom operate his business and at the same time have the fitness center. As I understand and I'm listening to him here today, tonight, his problem is that he does not want to give up too much of a commercial advantage with his office in order to have the fitness center. And he's told me that if he does, then he won't have a fitness center, and I think that will be a loss to the community. On the other hand, I understand what Randy had to say. I was very interested in the things he proposed. His concern, obviously, is simply insulating to the, in the best way possible the house next door. It seems to me that if you can come down somehow with, and I don't want to propose anything that Tom is not willing to abide by, but it seems to me if the way can be found to have a sign with the general characteristics that Tom's sign has, in other words, to allow him to keep that sign and still take care of the other problem, then I would hope that you would do it, because I think if we lose the fitness center, because Tom has to concede too much of his commercial opportunities in that business zone, then I think the town will have lost something worthwhile. I think the kids in the high school will have lost something worthwhile nearby. And I think it's wonderful that the fitness center is going to be where we want to center most of the activities in the town, right here in the center of town. So I'm hopeful that he won't lose his sign. I guess he's not going to lose his sign. The other way to put it is, I'm hopeful that we won't lose the fitness center because the price would have been the sign. Thank you.
Thank you.
And again, I think that, you know, Randy's concerns that he raised are significant, but I think that there is a middle ground that will let Tom keep his sign.
Thank you very much. Yes, sir. If you could just identify yourself. And
sure. My name's John McDonald, and I live on Peebles Cove Road. Just to make it brief, I have just the two issues that have been raised. I am completely in support of his fitness center. I've had two kids that are at Cape High School that I've driven into South Portland for 2 years to go to the weight room to work out there, and I think it's important to have that type of facility here and not have to take them someplace else for that. As far as the sign goes, I think that sign is an important part of the community. I drive to Augusta every day, and when I come back, it's a nice feeling to see that sign there. It's a welcome home to me. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name is John Brady. I live on Spoondrift Lane. And I appreciate the concerns that you folks have as far as the signage and maintaining the integrity of the town. I work in Saco and every day go back and forth on Route 1 and see the proliferation of signs like that. In fact, I never really noticed them until this evening on the way home because I knew the signage was an issue. And there are a number of things like hunting safety courses and Wicked Good Bottle Redemption. And good news, Jolly is back. He's down there. And certainly we don't want to see that happen on Main Street here. I, too, look forward to reading those signs, Tom's sign, as I pass by. As a coach, I've had several teams be recognized. Several individuals have also been recognized there. And I, too, feel it's a little bit like coming home. I'm not in the market for a home, so I don't generally look at the sign for that. But Tom, more frequently, I think, than not, is recognizing somebody up there. So I, too, feel that the sign is an important thing. I'm a member of a health club in Saco. It would be a lot easier for me to be a member of a health club right here in town where I wouldn't have to do so much travel. So I hope you will consider that. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Barry Zimmerman. I'm a resident of Cape Elizabeth, but I'm also an attorney, and I think Tom has used me as a sounding board for this issue over the past several months. I'd really like to talk, though, I think, as a resident. With respect to time of operation, which Randy mentioned, it seems to me time of operation is an important issue because I think some people would go to a fitness center 7:30 in the morning, 7 o'clock in the morning before going to work. So I wouldn't like to see a restriction in that regard. I would hope that the additional stockade fencing that is being talked about might help in that buffering situation. And additionally, and finally, with respect to the sign, it has been broached before, but you will ride through a lot of areas and see signs that for the first week, the first month, are effectively used, and then they deteriorate, and it's a letter here and a letter there. That's not the case with this sign. It is one of the most effective uses for a commercial purpose that I've ever seen, but it's also an effective use for community purposes. And as everyone has noted, it is used to recognize local people who have achieve something or a team or an announcement of an event. And it is an important part, I think, of the area of the Cape. And I also think that the sign that's used by the public safety people is very appropriately used and an effective tool for the town. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
I'm Paul Vos, and I'm a resident of Cape Elizabeth. And I play basketball a couple nights a week at the in the rec program. And I also work in real estate, and I think that Tom's sign is a really good commercial use. And also, being aware of playing basketball with Tom, I'm aware of how much work he's done with a lot of the children growing up in this town, and literally coached them right through their grade school into high school and out of high school years. And to see people recognized like that, and to at this age in my life live in a community where people are pulling together like that, I'm pretty happy about that. And I support his use of the sign, and I would be real happy to see a fitness center there. I would use it, and maybe even be a better basketball player.
Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Phil Jones. I live on Bayberry Lane, and I have a son in high school who Tom has coached for years, and he belongs to a fitness center in South Portland that they do go to before school or after school, and I think it would be very useful if it was out here. We had one. It would save a parent a lot of driving back and forth, and to jump on the bandwagon on the sign, you know, it's very useful. Everybody looks at it as they go by, and it honors everything, and it's also good for Tom's business, which I think is a good tool. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other people wish to speak? Okay, at this time, I think I'd like to open it up, perhaps if Mr. Tinsman, you come back to the podium, if we have questions from the board. I'd like to proceed. We're falling behind on our schedule. I'd like to proceed, if we can, with questions directly on the site plan itself. And I'll open up to board members to start questions, comments. Janet?
I have a couple to start with. I guess, Mr. Tinsman, it's quite clear that if we were voting on your character tonight, we wouldn't have much problem with that, since you've obviously demonstrated a very important service to the Cape for quite a long time. I guess, unfortunately, we have to focus on the regulations and statutes that are before us, so I'd like to concentrate first on the sign itself and ask, Maureen, I don't know whether you've had a chance to analyze how the sign right now does not conform to the sign ordinance that was passed since the sign was constructed.
I was discussing this with a code enforcement officer this afternoon, and his concerns about the sign having to conform to the existing sign ordinance just started coming forward last week. But as I read the ordinance right now, you're limited to a maximum of 75 square feet of sign area per business establishment. And as I believe Ernie told me this afternoon, the top part of the sign, and you can correct me, Tom, if I'm wrong, measures 3 by 6, which would be 18 square feet. And at the bottom of the sign is, I believe, 4 by 6.
Yes.
So that's 24 square feet. So that's 42 square feet on one side. And both sides would be 84 square feet, which to me is over the 75 square foot limit.
Is there any other way in which the sign does not conform to the sign ordinance?
There is a requirement in the sign ordinance that if you have a message board, it can't be any larger than 32 square feet. And in that sense, the sign conforms because the message board part is 24 square feet. There is also provision in the ordinance that talks about a freestanding pole sign, which the whole sign you could talk of. And that is supposed to be no larger than 20 square feet per side. But there is right now For us, we'd have to look at it a little bit longer, because obviously it's 42 square feet per side, which is in excess of that freestanding sign, but it's not in excess of the message board sign. So I think if you were very conservative with the ordinance, you might argue that the sign itself is not too big, but that there's too much signage on the site, period.
Are there any lighting requirements in the sign ordinance that would be applicable to this sign?
Yes, there are lighting requirements, but it is, at this time, technologically, it is very difficult to measure brightness. And there was always an intent on behalf of the ordinance committee and the council to restrict signs that were too bright. And we looked into trying to find a very specific technical standard. Unfortunately, the equipment just to measure brightness would cost in excess of $25,000. So there's a standard in the sign ordinance that talks about the sign cannot be too bright and has to be conforming with the brightness of lighting in abutting areas.
And is there anything else that would be something we should note in the way of nonconformance?
What's the issue with the backlit signs?
Well, in addition to the requirement for brightness, there are also some other requirements that talk about buffering and landscaping, which I'm looking for. The whole idea with the nonconforming sign is, the way the sign ordinance was passed is, if you're not proposing to make any changes to a sign other than regular maintenance, that then you would be allowed to maintain and retain a sign that doesn't comply with the existing ordinance. But once you wanted to make a substantial change to the sign, and the code enforcement officer is interpreting the site plan review and the addition of a new use as a substantial enough change to warrant making the sign come into conformance with the existing sign ordinance. And as I understand the town attorney's letter, he also agrees that the site plan ordinance can be used to bring the sign into compliance. If I may point out, I'm not sure how many of you have a copy of the sign ordinance before you, but under Article 4, Special Sign Standards, under D, it talks about illumination. Illumination of signs from an external light source shall be shielded so as to prevent glare onto a public way or private properties. No sign shall be illuminated in a manner which creates a public hazard by adversely impacting the movement of people and vehicles and the enjoyment of adjacent properties. Lighting shall minimize glare and reflection and shall be of an intensity and brightness in keeping with the general lighting level of the area. Hours of illumination may be limited to reduce adverse impact on adjacent properties and to conserve energy resources.
Okay, on one other issue that's been dogging us for a while, what is the code, this is again addressed to Maureen, what is the code enforcement officer's position with respect to whether Mr. Tinsman has completed all of the requirements that were necessary the last time around?
Again, in speaking with the code enforcement officer this afternoon, he stands behind the memo that you received last week. In particular,
that there
are still some items that were required from the 1989 approval that have not been completed. What I would do is point to the most recent plan that's been submitted by Mr. Tinsman, and if you look at the plan and you look at the rear portion of the house and draw a horizontal line towards the Reich property.
Mm-hmm.
There is supposed to be fencing, which is depicted on the prior plans that you were submitted and the plan that was approved by the board in 1989. The fencing is supposed to come even with that perpendicular line. As depicted on this current plan, which depicts actual conditions on the site, you can see that there is at least one length of fence missing. And it appears from both the code enforcement officer and my estimation that there is one length of fence that was approved and has not yet been installed.
Mr. Tinsman, do you disagree with that?
Yes, I do. The site plan... plan sketch that you're all looking at clearly is marked off in sections of stockade fencing. Each post is marked with an X, and it clearly shows on the one that I submitted that there's 10 sections of fence, and that is clearly exactly how many sections of fence are up right now.
Have you notified Ernie McVain that you disagree with his conclusion?
Yes, I reviewed the site with Ernie today. He didn't argue with the number of sections. He saw there were 10 sections of fence. He was trying to draw a line across from the back of the building to show on the scale where the fencing should come to. And as I tried to explain to him that once I got a Class D survey, which you now have in front of you, it showed that the boundary line is not exactly where it showed it was, so things may be out of proportion. I don't know why that happened. But when I made my proposal to this planning board 2 years ago, it was to install 10 sections of stockade fence starting at the back corner of the parking lot. That's where I started. I installed 10 sections of fence, and it's now in place. And he doesn't dispute the number. He disputes where he felt it should have ended up.
There's also new fencing that is that you installed, but it does happen to be on the abutter's property?
This fence, this 10 sections of stockade fence,
right,
when you get to the end closest to the road...
To the building.
Well, to Ocean House Road.
Mm-hmm.
And to the building. The property line does cut across a couple of sections of fence.
I think, Janet, that we've got two issues. We've got the encroachment
give
of the encroachment of the fence on the neighboring, on the abutting
right.
parcel of land, which is a problem. You don't have right title and interest to go onto that property. That's an issue from the point of the planning board. The other issue being how far does that come down? I in the last weekend, I drove down in the driveway and just sighted the end of the building. There's a little bit of discrepancy because you can see there's a little protrusion in the back, which is a back porch and so forth. I would concur primarily with Ernie where the end of the fence is. It is back from just my own judgment. It does not go where the new fencing, it does not extend that far out. In my own opinion from being on the site, and just speaking as one board member, I'm not sure that that's a real big issue. I'm not sure. I think the stockade fence serves a purpose in the parking lot area. I think it serves as a type of very strong visual buffer to the rear of this building. I'm not sure that I, as one board member, would like to see it extended a great deal further. It's a very flat, hard-looking buffer. It's not a natural-looking buffer at all. I'm not sure that that's what we're looking for in a buffer. I do not concur with what it shows here. My own judgment of where it ends pretty much is back at the end of see the section where it says new fencing.
Mm-hmm.
Just to the east, maybe a half section down there. I went back down in the parking lot a couple times.
So you agree with Ernie, but you don't agree with the surveyor. Is that right?
Yeah, I wouldn't agree that the new fencing section comes that far, no.
That's proposed.
Is this new proposed fencing? What I see in yellow highlight here?
Yes. My proposal was to install three more sections or 24 feet more.
Than what I saw over
yes.
the weekend?
Okay. Yes.
Okay. I would bring it to... to that.
That would bring it beyond that point.
That's right. It certainly would.
And I don't know if you noticed, I had a stake in the ground where the 24 feet was, and it was substantially up the driveway. And Randy and I looked at that, and it pretty much blocked off.
That being so, that would completely.
That would go beyond
buffer,
what this proposed originally.
Buffer the rear of this building, I think, from the neighbors.
So, Maureen, would it be your understanding that what Mr. Tinsman proposes with respect to the fence would then complete the 1989 requirements?
It would exceed the 1989 requirements.
All I wanted to hear.
Except for it needs to be on his own site.
Well, yes, that would be helpful, wouldn't it? I suppose in no particular order, Mr. Tinsman, and obviously other people get a chance to ask questions too, I note that you're not intending to provide any shower facilities in the fitness center, and I wondered if you had done any market research or whatever to find out how much, if any, that would affect the usage. It might have something to do with the usage, it seems to me.
Yes, we have done a limited market research on that. And what we have found, and it was reiterated, it was mentioned earlier tonight, it's a little bit different, but I think more intensive use. The different basketball gyms that we play basketball in, take Cape Elizabeth High School because it's right next door, for instance, is open Monday and Thursday night, and there's 36 men that play up there on Monday and Thursday nights. Out of the 36 individuals, there's probably four or five that take showers afterwards. I don't know where they go afterwards, but... But, no, I think, seriously, most people tend to like to shower at home, and I think with this given facility being located in a residential area, that most people will want to come dressed to work out, and then go home where they're comfortable taking a shower by themselves.
But that would prohibit, well, not prohibit, but it certainly would deter, I hope, people from coming to the fitness center, doing whatever they're doing, and then going directly to work from there, unless they have facilities at work.
That's right. Most people that would hit it on the way home from work would be able to dress there, work out, and go home and shower. My hope is that people that want to work out in the morning will be able to come, still be able to get home within 5 minutes, shower, and then go. I think the people that work out during the day are usually dressed to work out. They may do an errand afterwards, but in joining different fitness centers over the years that I have, there's a lot of people that use these facilities that don't sweat that much. You know, they're not there to work out for a marathon or for the Olympics or anything like that. They're there just to get a mild workout, to stay in shape, and then there's some people that work out real hard and work up a tremendous sweat. At basketball on Monday and Thursday nights, those people work up a tremendous sweat, and they still dress and go home afterwards and take a shower. So I don't see that as a detriment. Of course, if it was a full-service facility that had locker rooms, showers, all the different things, then you'd be able to attract more people, which would have more people on the premises at one time. And that's not what we're trying to do. We're trying to have a high turnover so that people are not hanging around very long, that people will come dressed to work out, go in and work out, and then leave. So that's what our hope is. And with given this small facility, it's not a facility that we're trying to appeal to all people everywhere. There are certain people that will find this very convenient, and those are the people that we're trying to appeal to.
Thank you.
Other questions? Comments from Tom?
May I just offer a suggestion on the sign? In my opinion, it's extremely bright, and I'm not convinced that the brightness of the sign enhances its visibility. And I can certainly appreciate why a neighbor would see that there's a general glow that might be a problem, at least while it remains in a residential use. And that would be to simply gain access to the bulbs that are inside it and reduce the wattage on the bulbs. That seems to me to be something that's quite practical, and if you take the next wattage down and that's not bright enough, then go back with what you've got. But my concern is that we're using the sign as sort of a scapegoat for what I think are bigger issues here. But I certainly would see that as part of the a condition of approval that I would put on the application. I believe that I raised the issue of the survey when the plan initially came before the board. We have a survey before us, I guess, a Class D survey that doesn't have any bearings on it. It's certified or prepared by a registered land surveyor, so I'll certainly accept it on that basis. But I don't believe that it meets the intent of the site plan ordinance, but it's certainly more than we started with. And I'll only go as far to say as I think if we
had the proper base material to work from and look at and things were drawn to scale, we wouldn't be discussing whether these were 10 8-foot sections of fence or 6-foot sections of fence or whether things lined up. That's really the purpose of having plans prepared to scale. I also appreciate, Tom, from your standpoint, that you have a fairly small operation that you're proposing here and you don't want to dredge up a bunch of old skeletons trying to get what is a fairly small project underway with limited funds, I suppose. I guess I'm a little surprised to hear about the shower. Do you intend to have any showers for staff members?
No.
People would be, would your staff members be involved in training? Would they be actively exercising during the day?
I'd like to defer that to Steve Anderson, who was the trainer on that.
I think probably the majority of the instruction would not be practically oriented. They wouldn't be working out with them. They were providing an oral support.
Okay. How many employees are you anticipate having?
Probably 4 initially, and then depending upon demand.
And how many members do you anticipate being able to accommodate in the facility at
one
time?
We're looking for approximately 200 to 300.
200 to 300 members?
Cast at around 300, yeah.
And how many would be accommodated in the facility at one time?
Probably no more than 40.
40.
20,
and you have
40.
15 parking spaces?
I'm not sure.
15. Do you anticipate that a lot of people would be arriving sharing parking, sharing cars, ride share or something?
I'm not sure. With the close proximity to the grocery store and the small mall there, they may walk over, may have some foot traffic from the school department as well. Perhaps mothers would carpool in the morning.
Okay. Well, I have some suspicions that the parking may be an issue, but I'll let that be market-driven. If you meet the ordinance, that's fine with me. I think is in some cases the market may demand more, but that will be then an issue for you to resolve. The issue of the fence, it certainly seems to me that if Ernie has an understanding or has interpreted the original approval that the fence would be extended to some distance along the property line, that I would go along with his interpretation since he is our code enforcement officer. But I would like one more clarification on the fence. The new fence that you indicate on this small 8.5 by 11 survey, are you saying to us that that's 3 8-foot sections of fence?
Yes.
If you lay down anything that sort of uses a scale of the width of the driveway and rotate it around, it seems as though the fence would come up quite a bit further than what you're depicting there. I think that would work to your benefit in just keeping things in scale. Now, I would request that these proposed improvements are drawn to scale and that the site plan is amended to show them accurately. Another question on hours of operation. I use the pool on a regular basis, and the pool typically closes at 9 o'clock, and people clear out at 9:15 or so. And everyone who does use a pool, as far as I know, uses the showers. Are you aware of any other programs in the school or in community services that runs later than that?
Men's recreation, basketball, generally people get out of there as late as 9:45.
At 9:45.
I've heard people getting out of classes over there at the high school around 10 o'clock. I've been at my office late at night and heard lots of car doors closing and cars leaving there around 10.
Leaving town hall?
Leaving the high school.
Okay. And 6 a.m., what do you anticipate? Is that something as a window that people would show up at? Again, I see activities at the high school start as early as 6:30 typically. Do you anticipate having members there and actively involved in training at 6 o'clock in the morning?
We're hoping that with the number of different people that will use the facility that we can appeal to their hours and schedules. We notice that, I notice when I get to the office early some mornings that the Lifeline program run by the university has people out walking the track at 6:30 in the morning. I've also noticed that the swim teams at the high school oftentimes will have their teams come in and train before school starts, and generally they'll be there at 6 o'clock in the morning sometimes. We're trying to have hours that will allow people to use the facility, and if we're only looking for 200 to 300 members for the facility, we'd like a wider spectrum of hours so that there won't be 40 people there at a time. There'll be more like 5 or 6 most of the time, and that's what I envision the use being. But it'd be a shame to have a facility that isn't open when people need to use it, and that's why we cut back on the hours on the weekends. We understand that people do want to sleep in on the weekends and would have the facility open a little bit later on the weekend and close a little earlier.
Okay, that concludes my comments. Thank you, Tom. Other questions? Judith?
I, for one, would like to see this move. I have a few comments. Number one, with the hours of operation, I agree that it's a fitness center and people are going to want to work out earlier in the morning. My thoughts were that you have the school buses that start to go in there. Well, first class is what, 7:10? So they're starting to roll in.
6:30.
In that vicinity. When I had a high schooler on the swim team, she was there at 20 minutes past 5. And again, the Lifeline people, I think there's traffic there. I don't see, as one board member, it's not a problem for me that you'd be starting at 6 o'clock. Number two, I also like your sign. And we have been through the sign business, and you've been involved in it peripherally through the sign ordinance. We had a lot of input with respect to backlit signs specifically, which was an issue. And I understand that this is an opportunity to readdress your sign. I've thought a lot about your sign over the last 2 years, and I'm not going to change my position, and I think that your sign should stay the way it is. Number three, I'm still bothered somewhat by the buffering. My own feelings right now are that I would like to see the encroachment adjusted with the removal, the three more sections installed. I'd be extremely receptive to a little more planting, if not a lot more planting, particularly where the trees are, you know, they're really up high. I would add parenthetically that you interestingly have two plans which show your fences on two different places. The earlier one shows it well inside your property line along the edge of the parking lot, and the other one shows it on the property line, in fact off the property line. So it's tended to throw us off a little bit.
Well, I wanted them to have a matching sign next door's fence, so I put a little on theirs and a little on mine.
Share it. I'm in favor of the project. I've supported what you've done in the community. I like the sign. I'd like to see the sign. It could be turned off at 10 o'clock, and that would be all right. It could be dimmed a bit, but I wouldn't want to see it go completely. And that's what I have to say.
Any other comments?
I guess first I would have a question for Maureen. I assume somewhere in the ordinance when Ernie McVane looks at this, there is some standard that will dictate the maximum occupancy of this, since other buildings have those.
Maximum occupancy is usually determined by fire code. And I frankly don't have the number right at hand, but this building definitely would have a maximum occupancy because of fire code and because of the number of access points it has. And I can get that information for the board, or perhaps the acting fire chief could provide some information.
Depends on the square footage and the regular hours.
Just to give us some sense, this is approximately 1,000 square feet, what, two entrances?
How many entrances are there directly to the outside? There's one, isn't there?
One entrance on 1,000 square feet?
Wouldn't want a ballpark square footage on a number of feet.
Okay.
Okay.
I've talked to Ernie about that in the past, and we certainly plan to abide by
the code. In other words, there's a set regulation in place. We just don't know what it is.
Just for the board's information, the maximum occupancy for the community center at 1226 is 49 people.
And how large is that?
It's significantly larger than 1,000 square feet.
I guess I have a few other general comments. And also would comment that I'm not voting tonight, so for what they're worth. I am not wild about how bright the sign is, and I think Tom has a good idea that would cost next to nothing. I will also admit I read everything you have there, so I don't know where I fall on it. I do enjoy your messages. I'd like to see what's for sale. I do have some problems, though, with the hours of operation. It seems awfully early, but I also am driving down that road at 6 a.m. too for a class, so I don't know if I would attack the morning hours. Certainly the evening hours seems awfully late if you just compare how late the IGA is open and other activity right there. And I'm certainly not anti-commercial use, but you have to realize that you have a property next to a residential property. Unfortunately, that was the situation. You chose to purchase the property and develop it. And certainly if that property came in for a zone change, I would welcome additional uses in your property or additional hours, as the case may be. I would certainly propose limiting the hours of operation at least 9 p.m. That means people could get out of there and the lights out by 10. Trying to think. Buffering, I would certainly favor at least three more sections of fence. I think I would echo what Tom said also about cleaning up the plans. I'm not pointing any fingers, and I think the board is awfully new, but it's very frustrating to see that this was approved last time with inaccurate boundaries. A lot of these issues wouldn't be here right now if we would have had something a little bit different. So even if it were an after the fact, I'd like to see something that you could put a scale down, and there would be absolutely no argument about where the fence would go. My intention would certainly be to come up and past the corner of the house. I could even see more personally, but I would not move to require that. I guess that's all I have to say.
Yeah, Judy. Thanks, Stephen.
A couple of points. I think it would be worthwhile trying the lower water valves as well. And I also read the sign daily as I drive by. Appreciate reading what's on there. One thing that does concern me, however, is the parking overflow. If you have every business has one, a peak time when a lot of people decide to come work out, where are they going to park? Are they going to park on Route 77, or will you be able to create more parking on your own site?
I have a lot of room on the property that's not utilized right now. It's all lawn space, trees, and whatnot. The parking would not be a problem to expand in the future at all. Also, my property does border up to the high school parking lot. As a matter of fact, just the other side of that chain link fence on the west side of the property is all parking, the whole length of the boundary of my property. So there is substantial, and I think there's probably close to 50 parking spots back there that abut my property.
Couple last comments. I think the hours are fine. I know myself, I go running every morning at 6, so 6 o'clock seems a reasonable time to go work out. It seems to me a closing time at 10 o'clock at night would be an appropriate time to have the sign shut off due to signal to the public that the facility is closed in consideration of the neighbors. And that's it.
Thanks, Steve. I guess I just want to summarize some things, and I have some questions or comments of my own. You spoke originally, or at the end of your first presentation, the give and take nature of a site plan review. I think perhaps this board may have given too much in not requiring a more substantial site plan or site or plan the first time around. That's already happened. One of the unfortunate things is very confusing for us to look at two plans of the same property that aren't alike. And there are significant differences. You've lost the 13-foot. What was originally on the original plan showed a 13-foot-wide swath where there was plenty of room to buffer the signage in the front of the property. There are other issues that just make it very difficult. The setback, the offset of the entrance of the driveway, we're down to 1 foot instead of 13 feet, or approximately 10 feet, at the original. I guess, and I'd like to have Maureen be thinking about this, I'm not even sure how should we take action on this tonight, what plan we refer to. I think we don't have much choice but to refer to a sign, to a plan that's sign or I guess it's signed by a registered land surveyor. At least it states that it's prepared by a land surveyor. How technically or operatively we carry some of the issues from the first site plan to this plan itself. I guess the parking issues that you brought up, you keep mentioning some off-site parking, the parking in the high school parking lot, the parking in the IGA parking lot. There are a significant number of members anticipated. And I think it's great that they walk from other locations. The number one item in our ordinance states 19.24, a recreational facility is required to include plans for safe pedestrian circulation to nearby commercial and recreational areas and to adjacent neighborhoods. I don't see anything on the site plan referring to, and I'm not even sure that that's a requirement, but certainly when you speak of pedestrian traffic, it's our responsibility. As a planning board, if it states in the ordinance that we have to give these things consideration, we have to give them consideration.
Can I address that just for a second? And I agree with those things. I want to make this pedestrian friendly because those who are going to be members. And the high school parking lot, I mean, that's an answer to overflows. It's not something I propose to use. I think there may be some people walking from abutting properties to use the facility, and I'd like to encourage that. The border to the north of my property is the high school entrance, and that does have a sidewalk, and many people use that sidewalk during the course of the day.
Does it have a sidewalk just abutting your property? Is that where the sidewalk
is? It's on the other side of the road, that road that goes into the high school.
Oh, that's good to hear.
So there is a sidewalk there. If there were a way. Now, my understanding is that chain link fence is right on the border of my property and the high school, and I believe the high school owns it. If at some point in the future the school would allow me to do that, I would be happy to put a walkway through there so that people coming from the high school would be able to use it. But that's something that I'd have to get permission to be able to do.
Mr. Tinsman, if the chain link fence stayed the way it is, how would high school students approach your property? What's the most direct route?
To come right around the north side of that fence, to walk right around that. The parking lot is right on the other side of that, and that's where I walk when I go down to the soccer games and down to the high school myself. I walk out onto that road.
I understand, but you have to understand what our role is here. There are safety issues involved, and if we approve a plan that promotes especially foot traffic of children. I think we just gave approval to widen this to 3 lanes wide here, and there's an esplanade and 2 lanes or 1 lane on the other side. And I'm not sure that the third lane goes back 210 feet, but I think it goes back 200 feet. I'm not sure that we're sufficiently addressing that, and I think some type of compromise may be able to be reached with the
one of the reasons that I overbuilt my parking lot. The ordinance says, with the square footage that I have in my building, that I need 11 parking spots.
And like I said, I was there, and it certainly is a large parking lot for the size of the facility.
And I have 15. So.
The issue of buffering, and I mentioned before the stockade fence, I think it's essential that the stockade fence be brought to where the point, whether it's 24 feet or whatever that point is, that is, as it shows here, and I think that will sufficiently buffer the rear portion of the building where the cars are and some foot traffic in the back. The sign issue, I don't think it's certainly not my intent to take any sign away from you. I think everybody enjoys your sign. Most people enjoy your sign. I think there is some issues with the brightness of the sign itself. And one of the reasons I stopped at your site over the weekend a couple times was to get a sense of the scale and really what it looks like. It's real hard to look on this piece of paper and try to figure out what's going on. If you look at it, if you're out in the street looking at the property, you'll note that Mr. Tinsman's sign actually is at street level, and then the driveway drops down 3 or 4 feet, and that's at the level where your buffering takes place in almost a non-existent width of area beside your driveway. The buffering at that point are the large spruce trees, or evergreen trees anyway. Those aren't on your property. Those are your abutters' trees. And in essence, what you have is a sign that really is like 12 feet above. When you get down to your neighbor's property, it's 12 feet high. I'm going to say 7 to 12 feet high, where the light shines directly toward their home. A 6-foot fence at that point is not going to do anything. The light itself is going to go right straight above that.
But the trees are 40 feet high. Right there.
The trees do actually, they're the best buffer that you have, are the existing trees that are there. One thing that crossed my mind while you're there, while I was there, have you ever thought of opaquing, I don't know if that's a verb, making opaque the inside of that lens on the south side of your sign and front lighting that side? Part of the problem is the glow from a backlit sign just projects a great deal further. And I think I'm correct, maybe I'm wrong, Tom. But would a front-lit sign, not the reflected light, would that be less?
Maybe if it were illuminated from the outside up
right
at the sign? I don't know.
Well, you know, lighting being an issue, I certainly agree with all the items brought up about the brightness and toning back. Maybe if there's 4 bulbs in there, cutting it back to 2. Shutting it off earlier, doing things like that, which I'm completely in agreement of. When we were discussing the sign ordinance and the sign before, the issue has come up many times about exterior lit signs, you know, with a bulb shining at the light, at the sign. And I've got to tell you, different places that I've been, those have been very annoying signs to me, because every once in a while you get a windstorm, it will blow the light to the side, and it will shine right in your eyes when you drive by. I've seen several signs that have done that in the last month looking around that have exterior light shining at the sign that is a little bit off kilter, shining into people's eyes or into windows and things like that, and it's just so hard to monitor. The interior lit sign has, you know, it is bright, and I don't question that at all, and if there's something we can do to work together to tone it down, I'd be willing to do. I've already indicated what I'll do on the top part of the sign.
I think that's an improvement. I'm not sure I understand how it acts differently at night than it does it during the day, but I'll leave that up to your sign
people.
Well,
can I give you an example of that?
Sure.
So maybe you can look at it sometime. It was given to me as an example. There's a Fleet Bank down in South Portland on the corner of Market Street and Waterman Drive. During the day, it's a blue backlit sign with white letters. When you drive by there at night, I don't know how they do it either, but all you see is the white letters. There is no color whatsoever coming out of the rest of the sign.
I just noticed that tonight also on another Fleet sign.
Yeah, it's just white letters, but it's blue during the day. So that gives you your company logo colors, but at night,
it's quite effective.
It really darkens the signs substantially, and that's what this proposal would do also.
Why wouldn't you do that with the section that says Cape Fitness Center? The same
just to differentiate the two different uses.
Okay. Any other comments of the board? Tom?
Steve, the only other issue I see is this issue of a performance bond or performance guarantee, and it seems to me that since there's not a public, there's no public property or public improvements involved here, that it would make more sense to think of something like a condition placed on the issuance of the certificate of occupancy.
Is a certificate of occupancy issued, Maureen? Or are we talking about a stop work order situation?
What I had discussed with the code enforcement officer is to not allow any activity that would convert the use of the property from the office use that it's currently under to a fitness use until the improvements were done. I would also like to note that although it's in a rather awkward place, under the subdivision ordinance, there's a specific requirement that allows you to require a bond for site plan improvements. So even though there's an improvement that's not necessarily in the public right-of-way, you would still refer to it as a public improvement, and if it was the desire of the board, you could require some kind of performance guarantee. In addition, there's also specific performance guarantee rights that are referenced in section 19211.
I want to be clear, the issue of if it's tied to a certificate of occupancy, you're saying that you don't think that he should be allowed to initiate any conversion of the existing property until the exterior improvements are completed?
That's the proposed condition. You may want to get a formal comment from the code enforcement officer. It's been my experience, however, that tying these types of things to certificates of occupancy is usually not very effective. People get to the point where their space is ready for use, and you have to be very proactive. You have to basically padlock the doors and not let them in. Mm-hmm. And once any kind of temporary certificate of occupancy is issued, people are in the building, and very rarely will a municipality actually go and force people to vacate a building because they haven't met their site plan requirements.
Judith?
Pursuing that just a bit further, do I understand then that he would not be issued a building permit until the improvements such as the extension or movement of the moving of the fence and the extension of it, as well as whatever else we might want, wouldn't be issued? I'm not real clear. I'm trying in my mind to get around a performance bond.
Right. The board has talked about the desire for a performance guarantee of some kind in this particular site plan. There's different methods of getting some kind of performance guarantee, most of which cost the applicant some amount of money. In the alternative, there's been discussion about not allowing any activity of as part of this approval to occur until those site plan improvements are done. When you decide that the improvements have to be done is something that's at the discretion of the planning board. What I'm saying is I tend to be lean towards more conservative, and I've in my past experienced major difficulties with getting these types of site plan improvements done. If the applicant is unwilling to complete them, my recommendation would be to not allow any building permit to be issued for any type of work that would be required as part of this conversion until all of the site plan improvements are completed. In the alternative, to allow the applicant to post a guarantee. I understand it may sound a little restrictive, but there are lots of site plans throughout this region that have never been fully implemented because there is no guarantee, and it's exactly the reason that it's in the ordinance now, is that there have been problems in the past.
Janet?
I don't mean to be too harsh about this either, but the applicant and I have already talked about this, and there has been some demonstrated proclivity not to toe the line here. So I would like to, I don't mean to require something that has to involve money, but I would like to provide a distinct incentive to get the site plan improvements done now and not 2 or 3 years from now or whenever it comes back to us. So I think that we're talking about two things. One is cleaning up the stuff from 1989, and the other is the site plan improvements that we would require as part of the ongoing 1992 application. And I think Maureen's suggestion is a good one, that we either tie, I think that if we're not going to provide C of O with respect to this issue, then we should have give the applicant the option, either post a performance guarantee of some kind or provide the incentive that you suggest, which is not issuing a building permit until, assuming that we have the right to provide those kinds of restrictions on the issuance of a building permit. Do we?
Yes.
Okay.
I look back to my notes, and I am going back to the abutter's comments or the representative of the abutter. And it actually wasn't from this evening, but before. The three key things that the abutter was looking for is that the project is done well, that it's done in a timely manner, and that the conditions are carried through. I think there are consequences, and I don't think rights are the right is the right word to use, but consequences or responsibilities of residential properties that buffer business zoned areas. And I think there are certainly consequences of people or businesses that abut residential areas. And it's that balance that is required. And there's some fairly clear guidance from our comprehensive plan of what this town wants to see happen with its own business area and how it wants to treat the buffer between those two zones. I think it's this board's, when we come to consensus on how we want to approach this, that we make the conditions as clear as possible, and that there are performance, and I'm not going to say that we need a performance bond, there's just a performance agreement to the conditions that, and I think, and I'll look for consensus from the board, but I think I certainly would lean toward completion of the site improvements before a building permit is issued. We shouldn't have to come back and try to clean up issues that were not completed from a 1989 site plan. And I don't think we'd be talking a lot about these issues if they had been completed at that time. At this time, I'd like to see the board try to move this forward, perhaps first by consensus and then move it into a motion if we can. We're significantly behind schedule with our last item. Do we have a start toward building this toward a motion?
I'm not sure I can provide what you want. I guess I'd like to ask Mr. Emery to speak particularly to the buffering issue, because I am concerned that there is not significant buffering now in the particular area below the low branches of the tall trees. I'm also aware that the driveway as it approaches Ocean House Road is less than a foot or approximately a foot away from the property line. What alternatives can you suggest, Tom, that would be, short of requiring the applicant to, or suggesting to the applicant that plantings be made on the abutter's land?
Really, the only two choices are either to continue the fence, which I believe you'd probably run into issues of sight distance at that point. The idea that there are a lot of trees here, there's a tree near the corner, and one advantage of having that open to a certain extent is cars approaching from the south can look through those trees now and see cars coming up the driveway. And it also enables someone coming up the driveway to turn right or left to have a better sight line down. The only other thing is a hemlock or something like that would initially provide a screen but eventually might die out because of shade. The rhododendrons certainly are going to take some time to mature and may never mature because of the narrowness of that piece of property. The only thing I would suggest as an alternative is that the improvements, some of those improvements take place on the abutting property and that the applicant provide the material. And perhaps the abutter could share in the cost of the installation of those materials. Ironically, these trees are exactly what one would hope to achieve with a buffer, and that as you go up and down the state and you see And I'll give you a good example. The mounds that are on the parking lot, the high school parking lots along the access drive between, by the IGA, there's that student parking lot that has a mound. And I have a real sneaky suspicion that those pine trees were created to create a buffer, were planted to create a buffer. And inevitably what happens is they get a little bit tall, people cut down the lower, cut off the lower branches so that they can maintain underneath them. And that's really what's happened here. It would seem to me that if the fence is extended the additional 24 feet and the brightness of the sign is reduced, that'll take care of a significant impact from the property. And the only other thing that I would raise is I really don't feel as a single board member that's my place to suggest to the applicant what to what extent that the buffering should be carried out. I really think that that's a proposal that he should be making to us.
Steve, is this still open? Can I ask a question?
Sure.
I'm just kind of curious, since it is a big discussion issue, how many board members have been able to come down and actually look at, from the property next door, the view of the sign, the buffering, and just what kind of light is spilling over on the property next door?
Like, I stopped several times.
Yeah, I saw you out there. Did anybody else have a chance to come down and look at
it? I've driven up and down there a number of times, and I've been in your parking lot once. I don't believe I've been in your parking lot during the nighttime. And I can't honestly say where, maybe Randy could shed some light, so to speak, on this, where the impact is greatest on the abutting property, because as I look at the photographs, there are a lot of hedges in front of the first floor windows. And oftentimes, it's a funny thing with lighting, is that it's not the fact that the light is literally trespassing across a property line. It's that thing called brightness, which tends to send, just like the moon did last night, send a glow into the neighboring windows without actually having the light pass that property line. Yeah. And I think that's more the issue.
Yeah. Well, I've tried to examine in trying to put a proposal together for you on what I would do for buffering, trying to consider all those things of what does a stockade fence look like when you put up a long section? It's ugly. What are these trees that are here actually doing? And what will the rhododendrons that I proposed and then planted underneath those trees eventually do? And when Randy and I had an opportunity to walk next door, really didn't see where the sign did actually shine into the windows of the house. It does shine onto the ground because of the branches underneath the trees, and I think toning the sign down will cut that back substantially. But when those rhododendrons are given a chance to grow, that will just about, well, I guess we've got to get together on that too, because those are on your property too. You can have them.
Do you have any idea of the wattage of the bulbs? And this sounds like a silly question, but when we went through the mobile station, we spent a lot of time on the lighting and so forth, and I'm not sure that we're highly successful there, but we keep trying.
I don't know what the wattage is of a fluorescent tube bulb. I'd only be guessing.
The insides of the sign, is there a split between the front and back, or is it wide open? In other words, the front and back, or the north and the south side are lit by the same bulbs, is that right?
Yes. Okay. So I guess when my question was raised, I question myself, what is the buffering actually trying to do? Is it trying to make the neighbors disappear from each other? Are you supposed to be invisible to each other? The trees that are there do create a very, very good buffer where the branches are. And the sign, being as tall as it is, doesn't sneak underneath those trees. And I believe that the rhododendrons, given a chance to grow, will be a very good buffer underneath those trees. And so I had hoped that we had addressed that, especially given the fact that the home next door has extensive buffering and plantings already in front of their windows.
I just asked Maureen to pull out what she had read earlier. And I'll just read from section 21.4.1.
paragraph D, and it talks about illumination of signs, and I think this is what we're looking for. Illumination of signs from an external light source shall be shielded so as to prevent glare onto a public way or private properties. No sign shall be illuminated in a manner which creates a public hazard or adversely impacting the movement of people and vehicles and the enjoyment of adjacent properties. Then it goes on and talks about the hours of illumination and so forth. I think when the glare or the illumination from a sign is a constant trespasser onto your residential neighbor's property, that becomes an issue. In my own inspection of your site, I think the best buffer you have is right there now. It's the lower limbs of those large trees. Unfortunately, those lower limbs are probably going to die out as those trees continue to mature. I'm not sure anything's going to grow underneath those limbs.
Well, rhododendrons, they grow in the dark.
They grow in the dark. I think it's going to be a long time. Like I said before, it's the 8 to 12 foot height where there's any thinness in your buffer. I just see that as a responsibility of you as a business person. I think, like I said before, most of the people enjoy your sign. I always like to see what's written next on the sign. But you have a responsibility as a business person.
You may be on it tomorrow.
Yeah. Don't try to sway me.
I'm just kidding. A lot of those low branches are down to the 4 to 5 foot level. I think there's one area where they may be up around 7 or 8 feet, but it's certainly not any higher than that. You can see from the picture that I've provided the mailbox that is set up probably four feet off the ground, you can kind of get a gauge for where those lower branches are on those trees. They really are lower to the ground than we've been led to believe. And like I said, there's probably one section in there between all those seven trees that it might be any higher than that. And the stockade fencing that I proposed to extend would bypass that area where the branches are the highest, so that it would take care of that one hole in the buffer.
I think there's some consensus on the board as far as the extension of the stockade fence to the point where it shows on this plan serves its purpose. This is one person. I'd hate to see a stockade fence all come all the way down the street. I think
I would too.
Be visually ugly. I'd like the board again to start to think about what are the conditions. How do we limit the brightness of the sign?
Mr. Chairman, the only issue that we haven't discussed with respect to the potential impact on the abutting property is the issue of right-turning traffic. Particularly during the winter months where at 6 o'clock it's still dark. I would assume that since that's a concentration of traffic coming in, that the headlights will come in underneath the trees and extend to the abutting property. And I, as a abutting property, I would think that one would find that annoying. I don't for a minute believe that over the next 15 to 20 years this is going to remain a residential property, but that's really not the issue tonight. The only other thing, Steve, that I would suggest that perhaps because of the dense tree cover, the fact that rhododendrons are going to be somewhat leggy if they do survive there, if they survive the snow plowing and all, that perhaps a lower 4 foot height fence extending along and up to some safe distance away from the right-of-way line where you still preserve the sight lines would be an alternative to just marching that tall stockade fence all the way up. That's something that could be done along the property line that would fit along the driveway. You'd have to throw the snow to the other side of the driveway, but I see that as a compromise that could be accomplished on your property with less impact than the existing fence has. And probably would be the least expensive in the long run to install.
Yeah, and I don't disagree with that, Tom, but I think the concern of cars turning into that driveway with headlights even potentially early in the morning, and Randy can correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that room on the front of the house is a living room, and the bedrooms are up on the upper floors, so there wouldn't be any lights shining into any bedrooms at 6 o'clock in the morning. It'd be a living room. If they're up, they may see it, but if they're up, it shouldn't disturb them. Plus, when I pull into that office, and I do it every day, and I come in from that direction, I don't even see those windows. There's a tremendous amount of plantings in front of each one of those windows, so I don't see that as being a big concern. I think having stockade fence of any kind extending out to the corner of the property there would be almost like an isolationist type of attitude of making me disappear from people next door. And I've got to agree with Steve. I think stockade fence, if you run too much of it, is quite ugly.
This is a little bit unusual, but as a chair, I'd like to ask Mr. Blake if he'd come to the podium simply to address the issue if as the abutter's representative, if the applicant were willing to supply some buffering plants, whether the abutter would allow those plantings to take place on their property.
That's a question I don't think I can answer. I only represent them. I don't own it.
I was afraid of that.
They have some strong feelings about the property and what's happening next door. I probably tend to tone down their comments a little bit when I transmit them. I would hate to commit them. I will ask them that, but I hate to commit them to saying yes, we will allow that. I don't think they do a lot to encourage development over there. I'll have to defer, but I will ask that question.
Okay, thank you.
Just if I have two
sure.
seconds to respond to a couple of questions asked of Tom and Tom's response on the Tom Emery's question regarding right-turning traffic is a good one. Because you can see there's not a lot of protection there. The rear right-hand window, if you have a picture, is a bedroom, currently used as a guest room. And the room up over the front room is also a bedroom. And those two windows above is the master bedroom, and then there's a bath off that. On the front of the house is a library, and where there's minimal of planning against the house is the actual living room. So right-turning traffic will affect two, maybe three, depending upon how the lights turn. One is on the first floor, two bedrooms on the second. And the issue that we have on, they want to enjoy their property without having a lot of noise and a lot of light reflecting on it. Granted, Tom's sign does not act like a spotlight shining in any particular room. It just glows and highlights that whole side of the property, which they think is an infringement on their enjoyment. Thank you.
Just a comment on a 4-foot fence. Maureen, you might be able to correct me. I think the typical height measured for eyesight in a vehicle is 42 inches, so I'm not sure that a 48-inch high fence is going to help as far as any sight distance.
Well, I'd like to have I'm not suggesting that fence, as Tom stated, would go to the property line at all. There's a very large tree on that corner. I think it should be held back a little bit from the corner, certainly to the right-of-way line, and perhaps using a transition up. I'm not suggesting it has to be a stockade fence either. That last segment could be something more ornamental than a simple stockade fence. Normally, eye height in a car is about 3 foot 4 inches or so, maybe 3'6". Except for the Land Rovers and those types. And the headlights obviously are a little bit lower than that, so the fence doesn't have to be terribly high to block the direct penetration of headlight. It may need to be a little higher to deal with the glow of the headlights.
Judy?
In an effort to get things moving, I'd like to make a few suggestions, but I'd like to make one general comment first. I think we have a lot of legitimate concerns, and I think when they really should have been raised would have been 2 years ago. It's very frustrating that this sort of conversation either didn't take place or no real action was made on it.
I feel, even though I don't think by the ordinance our hands are bound, I feel in some ways legitimately they should be, that we, we'll put it this way, if Mr. Tinsman comes in with a substantial proposal for building, for instance, the fitness center that we talked about earlier in the year, I would take a very aggressive look at this property. The sign, the lighting, and the buffering, the kind of look I wouldn't take at it right now because of the past history. But anyway, given that, I'd like to throw out some conditions that we've talked about to maybe focus the motion, and you can agree with what you would or wouldn't. Looking at the motion before us, there were three proposed conditions. I would propose eliminating the second one, which called for a performance guarantee. The first one was that existing trees and landscaping be preserved, that the site plan approval will basically expire within a year if the development has not commenced. Further proposals you might consider would be to reduce the brightness or the wattage of the sign, to have an automatic shutoff of the sign at 10 p.m. and perhaps limit the floodlight operation to, that 24 additional feet of 6-foot stockade fencing be provided. Alternatively, you might say an additional length of fencing perhaps to the front of the building or further of 4-foot high fencing. That the existing fencing that is on the abutter's property be relocated to the applicant's property. That the plans be revised and drawn to scale in some sort of manner acceptable to the planner and the code enforcement officer. That the hours of operation be limited to 6 a.m., 9 p.m. Monday through Friday, 8 to 7 Saturday and Sunday. And a final condition, something in this order, that building permits for conversion of the interior space shall not be issued until all exterior site improvements are completed and until a revised site plan drawn to scale is submitted, which is acceptable to planner and code enforcement officer.
I would like to say that I agree with all of Judy's conditions, I guess, and perhaps this is a product of my training as much as anything else, but it does disturb me to have to vote on something that's in this kind of condition, and I suppose I would suggest that at least we consider asking one more time to have Mr. Tinsman get all of his stuff in order and have it be in a condition that we can vote on it without having to do these things that say afterwards make sure that everything gets coordinated and whatnot. I mean, it just drives me bananas to have to do it this way. So let me say that.
Mr. Chairman, the only issue I take with the suggested outline of the motion is the issue of site improvements being done prior to the issuance of a building permit. Sometimes that's just not practical. If you're in the middle of January and you need to plant a tree or a shrub, it's just impossible to do. What I do feel strongly about, however, is that anything prior to the 1989 approval should be in place before anything else is done to that property. Done in some fashion, either by actually installed, if it's physically impossible to install it at this time, then a performance guarantee or some other way of assuring that those improvements will be made are made.
I guess I would just ask, how do we treat the buffering in the 13-foot area that's no longer there?
I think the buffering that's in the 13...
What was supposed to be completed with the 1989 site plan was proposed in a 10 to 13-foot wide area. You're saying that those need to be completed before we proceed, is it?
Either they're, if they're not there now, I understood that they were there. I thought it was just the fence that was at issue, but if the planting is also an issue, that a performance guarantee be placed for that planting to be done this spring, or he waits until the spring after those plants have been installed before he begins building.
Steve, I didn't hear you shut this meeting off. Can I say one thing?
Sure.
I asked Ernie today when we looked at the fencing, how many sections short was I? Mm-hmm. And he didn't know. And I said, well, Ernie, where is the fence supposed to go to? And he says, well, right around here. And I said, well, why do you say that? And he says, well, on your original map, it looks like the end of your fence is right about here. And I said, well, Ernie, on the map that was approved, it called for 10 sections of fence. Is that what you see on the thing? He said, yes. I said, it called for 12 rhododendrons. Yes. And those were the conditions that were made. There are 10 sections, and there are 12 rhododendrons. The plantings are all in place. The fence, because of the new survey, is in the wrong place. All I can say is that the original back corner is exactly where the new survey that was done using an instrument shows it was. So the back corner is exactly where it was stated before. The only spot on this whole map that is not where I originally thought it was is the boundary line on Ocean House Road at the beginning of the driveway. That pin is in closer to the driveway than it looked when you get down to the back corner and looked visually straight to the road. And what threw me off the most was the row of trees that you see in your color pictures there usually dictates where a property line might be. I didn't know which side of the trees it might be on, but it was a straight line of trees. So that's the only marker on the original site plan that is different from what it is today. And I realized that having that one pin at Ocean House Road be off does throw off a lot of other measurements. But you have before you now a scale of exactly the way it is, which was done by instrument, by a registered land surveyor that is very, very familiar with the Cape Elizabeth area.
I understand that, and then that should have been a requirement of the first site plan. That was a fault of the board, that we didn't have that. I don't find that as an excuse why we're talking about the issue. I mean, the problem is we're still dealing with, and Janet, there's a frustration. I share the same frustration, and, you know, when we had a site plan that is as drastically different from one point in time to the next, sometimes we feel as a planning board when an application seems to be this minor, that we put an applicant through so much work. These are the reasons why. You know, if we simply had asked for it up front, we probably wouldn't have had to address a lot of these issues now.
Mm-hmm.
The fence wouldn't be in the wrong place. We would have known how much bordering we couldn't have done the first time around.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're trying to correct the issue so that we treat you fairly as a businessman in this community and the residential neighbor who, mm-hmm. who resides and owns property.
And I appreciate that. But we have before us a scale that has the correct measurements on it, shows where the fence is, where the fence should be. I will put the fence where it should be. The plantings are in, and you know, I'll work that out with the abutters as to whether or not they stay there, or I guess they would have to stay there. I mean, and they're welcome to be there. You know, I,